Hello, everybody. This is Brother Luke, Sin City Preacher. I think the title of this video will be Faith of Christ or Faith in Christ. First, let me say that I think it would be helpful if you would watch a video I made several years ago titled Faith, the One Requirement. In that video, I tried to explain exactly what faith is, and that the fact is that faith in Jesus for our salvation is the only requirement in order to receive the gift of salvation and eternal life. But I did talk about in that video great detail explaining exactly what faith is. And I'm going to quote a couple of verses here that refer to this. First, I'm going to look at Hebrews 11:1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Okay, so the substance of things hoped for. When we hope for something, that means that we're not sure it's going to happen, but we're hoping for it. So when you have the word hope, you don't have the word certainty associated with it. Hope means uncertain, but hoping for it. So it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for. Okay, so we are hoping for eternal life because of our faith in Jesus Christ. Now, are we certain that we're going to receive this eternal life because of our faith in Jesus? Obviously, anybody could argue that you cannot be certain. I mean, I can be convinced in my own mind, but I cannot necessarily prove it or to anybody else's satisfaction that this is a certainty. I can show from the scriptures that it is a promise, and that because God promised me eternal life, and God is faithful and to keep his promises, that for that reason, I have confidence. I have faith that it is true. But it says here, Hebrews 11:1, it's the substance of things hoped for. What am I hoping for? I'm hoping for salvation. That means I do not go into the lake of fire, suffer the second death. I'm saved from that. And instead, I am going to receive this free gift of eternal life because of my faith in Jesus. That's what I'm hoping is true. That's what I'm believing is true. Now, the evidence of things not seen. So, if it's things not seen, obviously, we have to have faith in it since we haven't seen it. The best example I can give you is when the Apostle Thomas, often called Doubting Thomas, he doubted that Jesus actually was raised from the dead bodily, even though all the apostles told him that it had happened, but he doubted it. He didn't believe it. He said, I will not believe it unless I see him with my own eyes, unless I touch him. I'll have to actually stick my fingers in his wounds, and then I'll believe. So this verse, Hebrews 11:1, it says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, and it's the evidence of things not seen. So in order to have faith, it has to be something that is not seen, is not touched. Because once Thomas saw and touched Jesus, he didn't have faith. He had proof, he had knowledge, he had certainty. He didn't have faith. Now, let's look at 2 Corinthians 5:7. It says, we walk by faith, not by sight. This is making the same point as in Hebrews 11:1, when it refers to sight. In other words, the evidence of things not seen, and it says not by sight. So once we see Jesus face to face, once we have the opportunity to embrace him, to touch him, then it is not faith at that point in time. But until we see him, until we touch him, then it has to be faith. It has to be based upon that fact that we're hoping for it, we're believing in it, we have faith in it, but we haven't seen it. So now let's look at John 20, 29. Jesus saith unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. So Jesus is confirming here the same point that when you see him and you touch him, faith is no longer an issue. But Jesus said, blessed are those people who have not seen, and yet they believe anyway. So from these we should conclude that faith is not seeing, not touching, not having that kind of certainty, and yet we choose to believe it anyway, to trust in it, to have faith in it, have faith that it's true. Well, so that is, I hope you can understand what I mean by faith now. And now I could give you probably more than 100 verses in the Bible that talks about having faith in Jesus or believing in Jesus. This word in is there over and over and over again. Believe in Jesus. Have faith in Jesus. Just in the Gospel of John alone, it refers to believing in Jesus, 99 times. So there's no shortage of verses that talks about believing in Jesus, having faith in Jesus. But now here's the question. These verses that I'm going to go over next have the terminology is just very slightly different. Rather than the word in, we find the word of. And so let's look at the difference and see what we can conclude from this. In Galatians 3:22, it says, but the scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise by faith of Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. So the question is, and when it says the faith by faith of Jesus Christ, are we to take that to mean that faith of Jesus Christ refers to Jesus's faith? Is it even possible that Jesus, and at this point in time, he's resurrected, and he's no longer the incarnate crucified resurrected Jesus. This is Jesus as he is today, and it's saying that the faith of Jesus Christ. So right now we have to think of Jesus as eternal God Almighty, not Jesus the God man. And so if Jesus is God Almighty, does he have the attributes of God Almighty? Is Jesus omnipotent? That means that he can do anything that could be done, he can do it. Is he omnipresent? Does he exist all places at all times? Is he omniscient? Does he have all knowledge? Well, those are the attributes of God. And as a Christian, I believe Jesus is God Almighty. He was manifest in the flesh. He became a man so he could die for my sins. But nevertheless, he is eternal God Almighty. So he has these attributes. Now, we know that when Jesus lived on the earth, walked among us before the crucifixion and the resurrection, that he had temporarily set aside some of these attributes. He was not omnipresent. He was limited to being at one place at one time. He was not omnipotent. He could not do anything. He relied on the Father and the Holy Spirit to work through him. And he was certainly not omniscient. He said that there are certain things he didn't know. Only the Father knows it. And so these attributes were temporarily set aside during Jesus' incarnation. But nevertheless, these are attributes of eternal God Almighty. So knowing that, my question is, does eternal God Almighty, Jesus Christ, have faith? If faith is substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, is there something that Jesus can't see and has to hope for and have faith in? No. Jesus is omniscient. He knows everything. He knows the end. He knows the beginning. And he also, because of that, he doesn't need faith because he knows everything. So why would anybody think that when a verse says that refers to the term by faith of Jesus Christ, why would we think that Jesus Christ has faith? God doesn't have faith. God doesn't need faith. God does not have faith because he has knowledge of all things. There's no faith needed. There's no hope needed. He has knowledge. So if faith of Jesus Christ could not mean that Jesus has faith in the way that you and I have faith, hoping for things, believing in things to come, having faith in the promises of Jesus Christ, that's the kind of faith that we have as Christians. But Jesus doesn't have faith. God the Father doesn't have faith. The Holy Spirit doesn't have faith because they know everything. So the faith of Jesus Christ, what are we to understand about that term? That's the KJV translation. If you look at other translations, it's translated not faith of Jesus Christ, but faith in Jesus Christ. Perhaps that's the best way of translating it. If you know me, you know that I was a KJV-only advocate for many, many years, and today I still prefer the KJV, and yet I like to look at other translations when I find it helpful to get another way of looking at it. But in this case, the KJV is the version that says faith of Jesus Christ. Most of the other translations don't. So, but my question is, how could faith of Jesus Christ, how could it possibly mean that Jesus Christ has faith? I don't think it can mean that, because God cannot have faith. Now, Jesus does have faithfulness. Even in his incarnate state, he was faithful. He was faithful to go to the cross and die for our sins. And now, Jesus Christ is faithful to keep his promises of eternal life to all of us who believe in him for it. So I believe that putting my faith in Jesus Christ is justified because he's faithful. He promises me eternal life. He's faithful. That means I can count on him to keep his promise. So Jesus was faithful to go to the cross. He's faithful to keep his promises to us now, but he does not have faith because he doesn't need faith. He has knowledge. Faith can only happen is if you don't have knowledge. You have hope. You have faith. You have trust. So those are not... if Jesus had faith, I don't see how he could be God if he had faith. So what are we going to make of that? I could explain it by saying that it's not translated correctly. Maybe the modern translations is a better way of translating it. Or I could say that the faith of Jesus Christ refers to the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. It says that by the promise, by faith of Jesus Christ, or by the faithfulness of Jesus Christ, we might be given to, to them that believe. So it refers to his promise in that verse. If he makes a promise to us, will he keep the promise? And it says by the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. So I think in this verse, it makes sense to think of the promise of, that Jesus Christ makes to us, and Jesus being faithful, then we can believe it. Another example of this terminology, Galatians 2:16, it says, "Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ." Now again, I just tried to establish that Jesus Christ doesn't have faith. So this verse can't possibly mean by the faith of Jesus Christ and that Jesus has faith. It has to mean either by the faith in Jesus Christ or the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. But it can't mean that the faith of Jesus, meaning that he has faith. It says, "Even we have believed in Jesus Christ that we might be justified by the faith of Christ," or the faithfulness of Jesus Christ, "and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified." So the point I'm making here is that there are people who see a few verses that state it in this way, and they want to create a new doctrine that it's the faith of Jesus that saves us. And I'm telling you, no, it's our faith in Jesus that saves us, and it's the faithfulness of Jesus Christ that saves us, but not the faith of Jesus in that Jesus has faith. He cannot have faith if he's eternal God Almighty, and he has omniscience. Finally, we'll look at Romans 3:22. "Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference." So another time we find this term, faith of Jesus Christ. So I would say that when we find the term faith of Jesus Christ, maybe we could look at another translation and see that it says faith in Jesus Christ, or we can understand it to mean that it's the faithfulness of Jesus Christ. But we cannot possibly take it to mean that the faith of Jesus Christ means that Jesus Christ has faith, because God cannot have faith if he knows everything. So now the reason I'm bringing this up is that I've had an issue with this particular take on that phrase for some time now. I primarily have heard this being used by hyper-dispensationalists, people. I call them Paul-onlyists. These are the people who say they are rightly dividing the Word of God, and yet I say that they are over-dividing the Word of God. They say the only thing that really matters to us in the Scriptures as Christians is Paul's letters. Everything else, we can learn from it, but it's not really to us. So basically, you can dismiss it because it's not to us. And they're Paul-onlyists. Only Paul's letters apply to us. So I found that these hybridees have made a big deal about the faith of Jesus Christ, and it's bothered me for a long time. Why am I bringing it up now? Well, because Brother Wayne Crook and his wife Elaine, they sent me a video and asked me to look at it. They wanted my opinion of it. Another video by Steve McVeigh. And he is making a big deal that we're not saved by having faith in Jesus Christ. And I was really disturbed by it because it goes on and on. And it's not our faith. It's the faith of Jesus Christ that saves us. And I think this is a horrible mistake to think that it's not our faith that's important, but the faith of Jesus Christ. And as I said, Jesus Christ doesn't have faith. He has knowledge. So I think it's easily proven wrong the way he's looking at it. But it's also important because a person has to understand that their faith is the requirement. I'm not saved unless I have faith in Jesus. It's not because Jesus has faith in me, or Jesus has faith. They've got it backwards. It's my faith in Jesus that is the requirement. This person, Steve McVeigh, I just recently found out about him. Wayne and Elaine sent me a video of his last week, because it was a video that supported our position on the idea that man's sins, all man's sins are already forgiven. And so we have reconciliation. The world is reconciled. And now all that's needed is believing in Jesus so that we can receive the gift of eternal life. I think that video was called Universal Reconciliation is Not Universal Salvation. So the Crooks sent me Stephen McVeigh's video on that subject, and I thought it was quite good. I recommended it to Brother Jackson, who does not agree with us on this point, but I recommended it to him because it supported our side, and I wanted him to consider it. And yet there was something in the video that Steve McVeigh said that bothered me. He said that everyone is in Christ, and not just the saved people, but the lost people too are in Christ. And I thought, well, this is, maybe he misspoke. I know I've got some videos where I've wanted to say something and it just came out wrong. Maybe he misspoke. So I wanted to know, learn more about Steve McVeigh and what he's teaching, and also Brother Jackson has told me that he's watched a lot of Steve McVeigh's videos. He says that he's very, very good on salvation by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. And he does have some things where Jackson thinks he's wrong, but Jackson doesn't consider it serious, but yet he disagrees. Brother Jackson told me that Steve McVeigh has a video called 101 Lies Taught in Churches Every Sunday. And each one of these 101, their videos are just like 2 minutes long. So I decided to start watching those videos so I can learn more about what he's saying and see if there's a serious problem here or not. Brother Wilson has also cautioned me against Steve McVeigh and sent me material on him. I guess his church is GCI. I think it's Grace Church International. And it was formerly the Worldwide Church of God, Armstrong's Church. And It was not a true Christian denomination in the past, and some people believe that they've corrected their errors and that it's a legitimate Christian denomination now. I don't know. I can't really judge because I haven't studied enough to say that they don't have critical errors still existing or not. So the question is, is Steve McVeigh, have serious errors, GCI, do they have serious errors? And that's why I'm addressing this now, because the idea that Steve McVeigh is teaching that it's not our faith in Christ that saves us, it's the faith of Christ that saves us. So I hope that this has not confused you too much, but I think the main thing that I want you to understand is that I don't believe that God has faith. Now, some people are going to say, oh no, they're tearing their clothes and saying, heresy, heresies, child of the devil. Maybe you think God does have faith. Maybe you think because of that verse there, God must have faith because it says the faith of Christ. But if we understand what faith is, that faith means you don't know, but you believe it, you trust it, you hope for it, you have faith in it, but you don't have certainty because you haven't seen it and touched it. Well, sorry, God doesn't have faith because he has certainty. He knows everything for certain. He doesn't have faith, he has knowledge. He doesn't need faith. And if he had faith, he would be less than God. So I don't want to just go on repeating myself, but that's the question. This term, faith of Christ, I believe if you look at modern translations, you're going to find most of the time it's translated faith in Christ, and that would be acceptable to me. Or if we understood the faith of Christ to mean the faithfulness of Christ, that would be acceptable to me. But if we look at faith of Christ, meaning that Jesus Christ has faith right now, I would say no. Right now, he's omniscient. He did have faith in his incarnation because he set aside his omniscience. So he had faith in the Father and the mission that he was sent on. And he was faithful to go to the cross. And he is faithful today to keep his promises to us. All right, well, I'll be interested in getting your opinions on this. I hope that if you believe in Jesus Christ for your salvation, then I hope that you can rest in the love and grace of our great Savior God, Jesus Christ. Thank you for watching.